Hi, everyone. Welcome back to the first day of DN. And I'm so excited to finish things off with our final keynote. And this is Mr. Ben Grossmann. Ben is the co-founder and CEO of Magnopus, a content-focused technology company of more than 150 designers, artists, and engineers based in Los Angeles. Ben works primarily on bridging the physical and digital worlds into a unified experience for entertainment, enterprise, and education. Ben is an Oscar-winning and Emmy Award-winning visual effects supervisor on feature films, where his work in virtual production has dovetailed into bringing virtual reality into filmmaking on The Lion King from 2019. So with that, Ben, I'm going to hand things over to you.
Thank you, Cordelia. It's a pleasure to be here today, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak to you about a little something here. I've entitled this presentation, "The World is Broken, and it's Your Job to Fix It," because I thought everybody needed an opportunity to wake up and smell the coffee. But if that's a little bit too heavy for everybody, a backup plan would be designing for a unified world, the future of digital and physical experiences. And I know that can be kind of a tough thing to imagine today, especially given the events of the last couple of years. It's hard to think that we're actually bringing the world together when in fact we are, because everywhere we look, we see that the world seems to be splitting into two halves, whether it's the rich and the poor, whether it's a left and the right, red versus blue, east and west. There are a million different excuses that we can come up with to say the world is actually tearing itself apart in many cases. But in reality, we're actually coming closer together in many ways. And now we have a responsibility to sort of say, how can we fix this? And one of the things that really, in our experience as humans in the last year, that's really happened is the pandemic. So if we kind of look at what's happened, we were all moving along just fine, connecting together, doing great stuff. And then we saw that all of a sudden we weren't allowed to be in touch with each other anymore physically. And so that took all of us, separated us, put us into little bubbles, and then forced all of our connections and communications into digital context. You know, we're all sick of Zoom. We're all sick of video screens. We're all like fatigued from staring at our computers all day instead of even just walking around and interacting with people around the water cooler, in the lobby, out on the street. But the reality is that actually has been sort of leapfrogging a trend that's existed for a while. And if you think about the way that the world has changed, and many of you are maybe not old enough to remember what life was like before the internet, but I was young enough to remember it at the time. The world was a very different place, I think, when we were all kids. The world was experience rich, but it was information poor. And what I mean by that is, if you think back to your early childhood, you probably weren't spending most of it watching Netflix on an iPad as a five-year-old. You were probably playing in the backyard, riding bikes in the streets, you know, scuffs, bruises, sticks, trees, mud, water, rain, weather. There were all these physical experiences that you were having in the playgrounds. Even if you lived in an urban area or a rural area, your childhood had a stronger component of that level of physical world interactivity. And so there's a lot of things about our bodies that absorb that kind of information very well and can just kind of teach us how the world works. But we didn't really have access to the kind of information that we have access to today on Twitter or Instagram or just Google News, like what's happening on the other side of the world, what are the Russians doing, what's happening in South America. This isn't stuff that was really at the forefront of our awareness. And so what we see today is that the world has actually become very information rich, but experience poor. And as much as everybody talks about like, oh, Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or TikTok are great experiences, to the human body, they're just not. They're flat, two-dimensional, small information. And we are not people who have evolved for hundreds of thousands of years to interact with that kind of information. This is a picture of my daughter. That was her in the previous slide when she was five. And everything for her was about running around the world, touching things, putting them in her mouth, you know, like getting muddy. And then as she's grown older, I've seen her just sort of get sucked into the iPad to the point where I snapped this picture just a couple of days ago when I walked by the bathroom because we told her go take a bath. And then she sets her iPad up and she just parks there and watches what's on the iPad. And I realized, she's living kind of a fractured world there. So for many thousands of years, we've basically been doing the same old shit the same old way. You know, we hunt, we gather, we farm, we travel, we explore, and all of that has involved being in the physical world in a spatial environment using sight, sound, touch, smell, taste, all these senses to create a holistic picture of how we relate to the world around us. But in the last 30 years, we all of a sudden got super derailed in a way that today we just accept for granted. You know, we forget that there was ever a world before the digital world that we live in now. And so we still experience this biological shock and this disconnect between our cognitive capabilities and the world that we're experiencing, because human experience has been mostly physical for hundreds of thousands of years. You could just look at a timeline of events, and I was really excited to be able to use some of the emojis that I could never justify before in text conversations to create this little presentation. You look at all the amazing things that we've done, and they're almost all physical throughout human history. And then you see that tiny little arrow there at the end. That is when digital happened. In the course of human events, it's like we've been using digital for 1 second. And now, if you think about how much time you spend doing digital stuff, it's immense. There are people who basically just wake up in the morning, they grab a bag of Cheetos, they put on their headset, they plug into some device, and they're there for 16 hours in some alternate reality that's a completely digital world. I'm not saying that there's anything necessarily wrong with that, but I grabbed my daughter's iPad and I took a screenshot of her usage statistics. She's 10 years old, and that's her digital existence right there on the screen. 42 hours a week of entertainment, 36 hours in addition to that of gaming, and 1 hour of creativity. I think Apple was maybe judging her a little harshly, because I'm sure that some of those other activities like Minecraft are probably creative, but it decided that in terms of creativity, she had only accomplished 1 hour. Point is that is a significant majority of the amount of time that she's awake that she's spending on the digital world, right? And now, admittedly, some of this is because of the pandemic, and certainly a lot of this will change now that I know what these statistics are, but you just got to look at it and say, if we came out, you know, 200,000 years ago as humans, and we just got digital really in the last 30 years, the ratio of what our biology has evolved to adapt is like 6,666 to one. I didn't pick that number. I just 200,000. It was really straightforward. And, you know, like that's super. So if you imagine what impact that's having, let me just put that into some context. I thought that this can't really be that extreme. Let's grab some samples. I looked at Disney parks and I said, if 156 million people a year go to Disney parks, like Disneyland, Disney World, Euro Disney, Tokyo Disney, any of those Disney parks that they have, and they spend 8 hours per visit, then that's about 1.25 billion hours of experience. So we're like, okay, cool, we got that. Now, if we compare that to Netflix, for example, 200 million subscribers. So if you got 3 million people subscribing to Netflix, then the average Netflix user consumes 2 hours per day of Netflix. That's 146 billion hours of experience per year. So if you pair the two, it's like the ratio is more than 100 to 1. It's an hour of physical experience to 117 hours of digital experience. And now that's assuming that you're even going to Disneyland. And if you compare all these other parks and all these other theme parks and all the other activities that you can participate in sports and all that kind of stuff, but then you add Hulu and Apple Plus and Disney Plus and all the other digital content, not to mention Minecraft and Roblox and Call of Duty and Fortnite and all these other games, it's pretty immense. The needle has swung rather drastically in the favor of digital. And there's another interesting observation about that, which is to say that it takes 130,000 employees to make Disney parks run, but it only takes 9,300 employees to make Netflix run. So the ratio between these two is immense. There's an immense amount of sort of capitalist motivation that says, hey, digital content and digital experiences scale really well. I make one and then I can distribute it to hundreds of people, as opposed to physical experiences, which are much more intimate, require a lot more work to coordinate between people. And so in the last several years of really spending time focusing on this, I came from the movie and television business and spent more than a decade working with big filmmakers on cool movies, and then realized we're creating a bunch of passive digital content, people to consume, and we're really struggling to make that active or engaging or immersive, or to trigger on all those biological parts of the human cognitive things like spatial awareness that really make people engage with content. And so we started exploring other things, and we kind of realized that we got to that fork in the road where it's like, hey, here's digital and here's physical. We didn't really take just one or the other. We took both. As a consequence, we've been living two lives. You know, every human that you know has one life they're living in the physical world, and then they have another life that they're really living in the digital world. Hell, they may even have a completely different identity. And so it's kind of time to acknowledge that as a society, we have forked these two realities. And then we've put all kinds of gamification and strategy and effort and surveillance capitalism into making that digital world really sticky. And that results in a world where we have people who just doom scroll on Instagram all day and then doom scroll on Twitter, and then they get a notification from TikTok and then they go click on that and scroll, 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 scroll. And the problem is that we find ourselves leading these hungry lives that are kind of missing the satisfaction of what our body expects biologically. And so we don't quite know how to reconcile those feelings. And it causes us to look for things that are like a spectacle that makes us feel an emotion, whether it's true or not, because we're just looking for anything that we can get because we've transferred so much from the digital to the physical. Now, that's not to say that, oh, the physical is better for this or the digital is better for that. Digital is an immense capability. But as designers, we've been kind of myopically focusing on one or the other, because doing anything that involves the two of them together is super complicated. So let's just take a quick look at some highlights here with what's a physical experience and what's a digital experience. Now, I don't have to explain physical experiences very much. It's the world, it's people in it, you're doing stuff. It could be sports, it could be going to a museum, walking around a museum, could be going to a concert, listening to music, you know, moshing people on the dance floor. It's been a while since I moshed at a Taylor Swift concert, but you get the idea. They give you experiences that make you feel. And so a lot of times when we work on movies and directors have to get into the visual effects side of things, it's like their interest kind of goes, because I'm standing over someone's shoulder looking at a computer monitor. Like, there's not really a whole lot of tactile feelings going on there. But when you're on a movie set, you're excited and you're energized and there's things you can move and things you can touch and things you can smell and things that you can change the lighting on and do all that kind of stuff. But when you're working with a computer, it's kind of like you just take the mouse and you're like, click, 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 click. And it's kind of a diminished experience, but that's what creates the visuals. So the physical world, multisensory, you get it all for free. It's great depth, you know, which I can't emphasize enough how important depth is to the way that humans are evolved. Like, spatial awareness and perspective and parallax is critical. Just being able to look at a problem from a slightly different angle and change the way you see something. We were just talking before how sometimes when we're trying to direct an image for the first time and they've gotten fatigued from looking at it, we just flop it. And then it's like their brain goes, oh my God, I've just changed perspective. And now I'm seeing this picture as though it's for the first time. But it's a spatially native environment, right? So when you think about digital experiences, we've really got really, you know, limited experience. Many of you have are full digital natives, what we call digital natives. You've never not known a world of iPhones and iPads and laptops and computer screens. It's never happened for you. But your body, because your body is carrying all these characteristics and intuitions from millennia of previous generations of development, and your body feels that. But your cognitive mind doesn't necessarily understand anything different. So we're talking about television, internet, games, mobile phones. They tend to deliver experiences that make you think. They can't make you touch very much. They can't make you smell very much. You certainly haven't licked the television in a while, and tasting Fortnite is a very dissatisfying experience. So we think about visuals, sounds, and some modest amount of touch and movement and, you know, heart rate and anger, depending on, you know, the experience that you're playing. It's all, if I'm in the physical world and I need a log, I go get a log, and the log comes for free with bugs and moss and sap and all these other things that if I was in the digital world, I have to add by hand. So what happens is that if you think about all these things adding up to the sum total of some sort of experience that you just can't quite put your finger on, and you couldn't have put in the spreadsheet if you needed to order a log on the internet and say, well, it must meet all these criteria, you'd forget a million things that are actually happening in nature. So you end up with minimum viable log, because of course we have to pay for everything that we do, whereas Mother Nature gives us a lot of things for free. So it's typically 2D, and I think I've kind of bludgeoned that horse quite a bit to make it clear that we see in neuroscience that two-dimensional stuff does not engage as much as spatial stuff. I would argue that that's partially because we were always so worried about things killing us that our body has developed really great capabilities for using depth and using human perception to really be able to read another person's body language, whether their intentions are to kill us or to make out with us, and all these things that they just don't exist in a flat phone. They don't exist on a flat screen. And so we have to cognitively emulate those things through logic. So if we think about the spectrum of engagement too, there's a finite amount of things that you can do between these two worlds, and they have their different advantages. You could think that a passive experience in the physical world is actually still a much more active experience than a lot of digital content. So if you just think about yourself scrolling through Wikipedia or TikTok, you're wiggling a finger. If you think about just riding in the back of a car, all kinds of shit's happening. You're smelling the smells. The wind could be blowing through the window. The car is vibrating and bouncing up and down. Your neurons are firing all over your body. But all you're doing is sitting there passively riding in the backseat of the Uber, just wishing that the driver would get there. And you can take that spectrum to the farther side, which is you're racing cars. And you can experience that whole emotional journey of, you know, power and control. And when you do that, your inner ear synchronizes with your visual system. So you're seeing and feeling and hearing, and everything's kind of working together. It's not the same when you're playing a video game of driving. Same thing with playing sports, for example. So if you look at digital experiences, you've got a similar sort of thing, but you've got TV and movies on the one side, which basically is the content itself comes with almost nothing but sound. And you sit on the couch, you brush Cheeto dust off of your chest, and you binge watch several seasons of Downton Abbey, and that's as sort of passive as a digital experience can get. You get to the web, you get a little bit of interactivity, you can click on things, you can move stuff around, cool, great. And then games is about as interactive as it gets. And now people say, okay, but wait a second, there's more. Like, we are putting these things together, and that's right. Digital and physical experiences have been around for quite a while, and interestingly, it's almost a very niche industry. Like, there's this very small vein of really talented people who create amazing shit that's digital and physical. You know, you see here on the picture a space designed by Team Lab. Team Lab is a team of people. There are many other people like Obscura Digital and a bunch of people that have created amazing physical and digital experiences, but they're super complicated and they're kind of all one-offs. They just depend on the space and they just depend on the digital content, and they're really hard to replicate. So they're really expensive it's really hard for one designer to master both of these worlds. We tend to find that designers specialize either in physical spaces, even just wayfinding and signage experts, or master plan architects and people who do layout and how do humans interact, people who do product design, things that you're going to touch, you know. And then there's people who work in the digital world and they collaborate, but sometimes not very well. I think even the industry at large struggles with how to put these two different teams of people together, even though they're designers, they couldn't be more on opposite ends of the spectrum coming at different times of the process. And so another thing has been that our digital devices that we all have aren't really aware of what's going on in the world with us. So we tend to just reinforce that design ethos of, I only care about what you're doing inside the screen. I'm not paying attention to what you're doing outside of the screen. And I'm not necessarily expecting the phone to know what's happening around you. And that's something that is on its way to changing. So we can even see that apps like Pokemon Go that say, hey, we actually are starting to give you some pretty basic functionality around, where are you? Are you outside on the street walking around? Are you in your home on your living room sofa? Are you at a theme park? Is there a way that we can help you connect more strongly with the world around you? And as we start to include things like artificial intelligence and AI on the devices, cloud-based GPU rendering, compute and 5G, all kinds of cool experiences become possible when your phone can actually say, oh, I see the things around you now. And so I can actually augment the things that you're experiencing. And that's kind of what a little bit of what I wanted to share here is that we've got all kinds of cool technologies coming that attempt to address this disconnect between the physical world and the digital world moving in two different directions. And if you think about how all those things can come together, technologists aren't going to do that. Like, I can tell you right now that Google and Microsoft and Apple and Amazon and Facebook and Snap and TikTok are all very much focused on laying the foundations of technical capabilities to thread these two worlds back together in order to create better and more unified experience. But they're not actually creating the experiences because they don't necessarily know how. So there are whole teams that are working on positioning, as an example. So we use GPS on our phones. That's how we know like where we're headed to that restaurant or you know where our dog is. And that's not very accurate. Like I actually need my phone to be immensely more accurate to say, no, here's where you are to the centimeter, not to 10 meters, but to the centimeter. Because if I'm going to say, oh, I want to put a digital character near you, I want to have one of your virtual friends from the other side of the world sharing this space with you, then I need to make eye lines match up, which means I need to know where that avatar is going to stand in front of you and how they're going to look at you and then how you can both turn and look at something else. And I say that not because the phone is a great UI for that, because nobody wants to walk around doing this. That's just a temporary bridge on the way to a new generation of devices that will take the screen from our lap and put it up into the world spread around us. So now that's where we start to get into some really cool stuff, like what's called the spatial web and the metaverse. So I just put a little blinkly twinkly things on here because spatial web and ooh, metaverse. So let's just do a quick reality check. What are these things? We all know reality. You got to be there. You've been there. You might have forgotten in the last year, but reality is still a thing. Then we've got mixed reality, where mixed reality is augmented reality also. It could be viewing through the camera on your phone. It could be using glasses that you'll see coming out really for consumers in the next couple of years. But you already see products like the Microsoft HoloLens, Magic Leap headset, some really cool stuff there. And if you haven't had a chance to play with these things, they're still, I feel like, prototypes or enterprise business use cases. But once you actually use them, it's pretty mind-boggling what starts to happen. And your brain goes, holy shit, I can actually see things in the world around me that aren't actually there but feel like they're there. And it's a sort of like hair on the back of your neck moment. Not that I expect everybody to walk around with steampunk goggles on the streets in the future, but as content drives the adoption of these devices, the devices themselves will diminish to the point of invisibility. And it doesn't have to be just digital devices that allow you to see. We think about terms like ubiquitous computing, which is acoustics, your watch, knowing where you are, what you're doing, what your heart rate is, and all these things. Oops, now Siri wants to do stuff for me. So all of that ubiquitous computing concept is coming in the current generations of everybody's technological development. So we could even consider some of that mixed reality, you know, IoT and whatnot. And then we have virtual reality, which, you know, someday we're gonna have to change the name of that because everybody still pictures like some bad 80s and 90s interpretations of that. But if you've seen the current generations of the Oculus Quest, for example, you see a very easy consumer friendly device that's kind of like a Nintendo Switch. And you put it onto a kid and off they go and all kinds of cool stuff. So it's a pretty cool experience, but you end up with this spectrum of engagement or reality where you can say, okay, in this case, I'm full in on physical reality. And in this case, I'm full on virtual environment. And even though we have been proof of concepting and point developing and testing and vertical slicing these different parts of the reality spectrum, we're starting to get into a continuous spectrum of design and development that says, instead of designing for one segment of this spectrum, we can design for all of them holistically. So to date, we've really been designing for two conditions in reality. One, where you look at the world around you, and so we think about that as physical design. And another, where we just think about digital, like it's an app on my laptop, it's a web page on my phone, it's an app on my phone, it's content like that. Now, I know that every designer who's been properly trained says, no, we consider the holistic experience of the user. You know, did they have Wheaties or Cheetos for breakfast? Like, do they drink water or Gatorade? Like, were they happy or sad before they picked up the phone? But in reality, the vast majority of design today focuses on either digital or physical, but not the two. So more recently, really, you know, sort of revolutionary and cutting edge designers have been spending more time thinking about both combined. And it's much more challenging. I can say this because I have scoured the world in search of designers who truly understand what it means to be a physical space designer, a digital space designer, and what the differences are between those two. And it's really hard. There's a lot of tools and a lot of skills that are completely wildly divergent. And, you know, I was talking to a friend of mine who's a wonderful designer, and they originally had some experience at Disney Imagineering, which thinks about theme parks and things like that, but then they had gotten into digital. They were doing alternate reality games, which are all just text-based narratives. Then they've been doing augmented reality spatial journeys, where it's like meeting characters in the physical world who are digital, having conversations and developing relationships, going on quests and journeys to discover things, you know, fluctuating the line between fiction and fact. And I was talking to them and said, where are the rest of you? And they said, there really aren't any. And that's what sucks, is that there's a very small community of people who have that capability to move back and forth. Now, starting to get more people who can design into virtual reality because they come evolved from the games industry, which makes it a much easier transition, but still have sort of habits and intrinsic motivations that come from having evolved games. And that's not necessarily the same target audience or the same design ethos or the same tools that you want to bring to a fully immersive experience that isn't necessarily targeted at a gamer, particularly given that so many games are first-person shooters, and the last thing we want is to reinforce shooting and competitive gameplay with people who are, you know, suddenly feeling that at a level of realism that's like 800%. So we look at those things and go, this is awesome, but the future is not to target and segment each of these experiences individually and say, well, we're just doing a physical experience, we're just doing a mixed reality experience, we're just doing a virtual reality experience. In the future, the tools that we're developing as a society will give us the ability to deliver a common experience based on the best capabilities of the devices that all users have across all platforms. Now, what I mean by that is, if you think about a game, people release a game. Oh, we got a game on the PlayStation. Cool. Okay. Well, now we've got that game on the Xbox. Cool. Can my PlayStation users play with my Xbox users? Well, that's not really been a priority. Can my PC users play with my Xbox users? Okay. Well, can my daughter on her Switch play with me on my Mac laptop? No. And it's like, well, you can make an argument for why that would be. It's like, well, we're doing headshots here. So we don't have time to like have one user be dumb and the other user be really fast because they have totally different devices. So we keep them segmented that way. It's like, no, it's also a problem that the form factors are different, right? How do you design a consistent experience when somebody wants to play on their mobile phone with somebody who has a desktop PC or is in VR or is in AR? And what happens when somebody is physically in an actual site that you're in virtually? Like, what happens if I take a theme park and I make a digital twin of the theme park, and now you're in the physical theme park and your family or friends are in the digital copy, accessing it this side of the world, but you can all see each other? What happens when we're playing a game like that? What happens where instead of you guys watching me talk about this stuff on a screen that's flat, you feel like I'm sitting in your living room and I can see all of you sitting in my living room and we're having a conversation? Those things can happen today, but nobody really thinks about designing for them. So we continue to design them apart. So that's where you come in. I'm glad you asked. The world really needs designers to reunite it by approaching a holistic view for design that says, I need to take into consideration the capabilities of a spatial user experience and all of the devices that a user has, and connect all the users together and make sure that to the best of their capabilities, they can see and experience and share the same things equitably wherever they are in the world. Now, I'm going to stop the slideshow presentation and just talk about that for a second, assuming this button actually stops that thing. Yeah, look at that. So basically, what we're looking at here is a new kind of designer who does have a foundation in understanding digital, who has a foundation in understanding the capabilities of cloud computing, who has an understanding of interface and user experience design on mobile devices, but then also makes a transition from thinking about two-dimensional interfaces and mapping them into spatial user experiences. So for example, I don't want to think about a diegetic game experience where I have a heads-up display on the screen. So you can see up here, there's like probably a little logo up there and a little logo up here and this little thing down there and you got a thing over here, and that kind of tells you like, that's a non-diegetic heads-up display. So wherever I move this camera, those things are just going to be anchored to the screen. That doesn't really make sense for a properly spatialized UI where I have a user to be moving around in the environment. So I need UI elements tagged specifically to this plant or specifically to that light or specifically to the wall socket or the plug or the trash can or even as they move through the environment. Now, the current generation of mobile devices has all that capability right there. And that's why they're adding all this. So if you think about it, why would companies like Apple go through all the added expense to add lasers to the phones? It's not so that you can, you know, measure objects really quickly. That's like a minimum viable functionality. They're putting that capability in there so that designers like you can say, huh, what can I do with that? And it becomes a gateway drug to say, oh, you know what? My phone just figured out my whole room really quick. And then we start adding a layer of sort of semantic organization to the world where it's like, well, now the phone can recognize, I know exactly what kind of plant this is. As a matter of fact, I can kind of tell you from looking at that plant that it needs water. Or I can tell you what the problem is with this thing over here in case you need it. Is this broken? Hang on 1 second. Let me put the instruction manual on that. Or you know what? Your friend over there has been trying to contact you for a while. The last time that you guys spoke, this is what you spoke about, and you said you were going to do this, so I'm going to help you follow up with. The devices suddenly have an entirely new way to offer the user context. And context is one of the critical things that we've always missed about our previous experiences with technology, is that we need a way for the devices to support our spatial response to the world around us by providing that additional context in space and time. So if you think about the earlier versions of what this was like, which is to say, both iOS and Android will do this now, which is to say they connect your calendar to the GPS of your maps, and they say, I have an appointment at the office at this time, so tell me when I need to leave and based on what the traffic is and how far I have to go. So when that first happened, that was some of the first contextually aware personal assistant stuff, but it doesn't really have a UI around it. It's just very textual. So if you think about what's possible now, when you start adding things beyond just where is this person and what do they have to do in time, which is a sort of primitive version of a space, time, context, and you start getting a little more accurate to the point where it's like, okay, now my device actually knows what these things are in the room. That's a chair, that's a picture, a painting. That's not just a painting, that's a Van Gogh. Like, we're at a museum and that's a dinosaur. I can actually make that content much more rich. Now, we have a lot of questions that we need to ask ourselves as designers. We need to make sure that this world that we're building is inclusive of smaller and more specific voices than just large global corporations like Google or Facebook. So, for example, if I go to a museum and I use my phone to find more information about a particular exhibit, we have to consider as designers, maybe I don't just want the Google version of that dinosaur. Maybe the curator of this museum has thought of a narrative that's appropriate to me specifically, and I should maybe get that to be accessible. Maybe I should be able to get in context to who I am and where I am, and also the relationship with the curator of the museum itself. Because this is an example of weaving the world back together, as opposed to saying, oh, we're going to put a layer on top of the physical world, but all going to be owned by a couple of monopolies that are going to provide all the information for us, so that's the experience that we're really digesting things down to. So thinking about creating that inclusive fabric that gets local perspectives and global perspectives connected physically and digitally in the context of users who have unique experiences and needs and wants and intentions is a very, very complex problem that, quite frankly, no one but a designer can solve. We have technologists doing a fantastic job innovating to provide these capabilities, but they don't necessarily know what they're good for and why. And we have artists seeing amazing things that can be inspiring to us, but again, don't necessarily connect very well to the technology. And as long as we continue as designers to approach things with this view of, I am designing for this experience, for this screen, for this platform, and rather than I am designing for this user in this world with this much broader and more immense range of capabilities, and I don't just have a human-centered or user-centered viewpoint on the needs, I also can step back and take a larger look at the community and the world around them and other users and what their contributions may be, and design a much more holistic experience that's accessible across all these devices, then we start weaving the world back together again and creating a much better user experience, not just for ourselves, whether working, whether we're using it for education, whether we're for fun, whether we're playing games, but also for our children. Because quite frankly, I've been blown away by the fact that I put a HoloLens on my daughter when she was 5, just to see it's really hard to teach a child. Well, it's actually, let me rephrase that. It's really hard to teach a 70-year-old how to use a HoloLens. I've tried it numerous times, and it's a time-consuming pain in the ass. But I put a HoloLens on a 5-year-old, and I tried to explain to her. I was like, yeah, you do this, and you do that. And once she figured out two gestures, she was off and running. Like a 5-year-old figured that device out in a heartbeat. And then she was running around, painting on the walls, you know, putting unicorns everywhere, creating all kinds of new experiences and things like that. And in fact, I think that a lot of times, just putting tools in the hands of children is a really interesting to see, a way to see what comes next. So that is, I think, what I wanted to share today was that it's important not to think about this next generation devices as like, okay, specifically this thing does that. So now I can take my mobile app and I can add a little bit of spatial awareness. That's one way of taking an existing pattern of design and expanding its capabilities a little bit, building towards something else. But what it doesn't do is give you more of that why we're doing this perspective. The why we're doing this perspective is not just because we can, but actually because we need to. Because if we don't, we're going to find ourselves breeding a new generation of millions of people who sit on their couches with a glowing light on their phone and just look at the entire world through a small, you know, 5-inch screen. And that's not exactly the future that is healthy or sustainable for anyone. So with that, I wanted to see if anybody had any questions or anything. I wanted to leave enough time, about 15 minutes in the conversation, to say, hey, what ideas do you guys have? What things are on your mind? Like, what are your concerns and anxieties as you're in school and thinking about where you're going next? So Cordelia, I guess, can you maybe toss me a question or two?
Yeah, absolutely. We have a lot of questions coming in, so I'm just gonna kind of pick a few randomly. But one question was, as you've mentioned, physical and digital experiences are complex. They take time, resources, and teams. So given all of these, how do you plan your design process? And how does all this innovation happen behind the curtains?
Yeah, that's a mess. And I would like to say that I have like cracked it and figured out how it works. But let me use an example. I'll just kind of talk you through this because you may not have experienced it before. And I will tell you, my background in design, I started making rave posters in the 90s. And I was like, oh, I kind of like graphic design and, you know, Illustrator and InDesign. And I was making posters. And then I got from posters into making brochures and then books. And then I started working in a newspaper making ads. And then I started making those pieces move. And I started working for a television station making motion graphics. And then, you know, flash forward to a time when I actually started working with large construction companies on the design of a physical site. And I was like, so how do you design this little city here? And they said, well, you know, we think about what people's needs are. And we think about, you know, people need food and people need water and people need shade and people need bathrooms. And then people have a purpose. They need to work. And so we spatially lay these things out like that. And then we also try to add a layer of design that is inspirational and kind of motivates people to think about things a different way. And I was like, okay, that's all very cool. Like, what about the digital aspect of this experience? They're like, oh, we don't consider it at all. And I was like, really? But you have all these screens and jumbotrons that they're showing in your designs. What goes on them? And they were like, that's actually a very good question. So we don't know. We design them with the presumption that someday someone will put something meaningful on them. And I was like, so it's not like at a train station where you go, oh, that's the board that tells me when the trains arrive. And they were like, well, that's one of the rare cases. Is a train station or an airport where there's actually signboard information that has a purpose and a function to the space. But generally speaking, what we do is we take our budget, we break it all up, and then we just have a small percentage that we add for signage. And we ask the customer, do you want more signage or less signage? And they go, oh, you know, like more signage. You know, like if you've ever been to Tom Bradley terminal at LAX, they've done an amazing job. Moment Factory did some mind-blowing stuff in that space with a lot of digital signage and digital screens that it created really inspirational content for, but you very rarely see that in the world. And the problem is that was an example where the architectural firm that designed the physical space actually included content designers before the process of design ended. But normally, the process of design actually ends for the physical space with just blank digital content screens. Now, what people are nervous about in that industry is that they're like, well, now the content on those screens has become more critical, but we need to involve these digital savvy designers earlier in the process, and we just haven't very often. We don't frequently. And so I was being involved in a very, very large exhibition design project that will be revealed in a few months, and Norman Foster Architects in London, and creating an exhibition that needed to start on the landscape outside, go into a really amazing building, and then weave our way through physical and digital experiences that all worked in harmony, so that a piece of physical content would kind of hand off to a digital one. And in the very inception of the design process, we even considered how to make a holistic experience with augmented reality glasses. At the end of the day, we decided not to ship them with the experience, but we had to design all these things together. And you basically had 30 people in a room at any given point in time who represented all of the different disciplines of all of these different pieces. And we found that there was a core design people who had any experience whatsoever in physical and digital and how to hand off between the two. Traditionally, what happened was all the money and time got allocated to the physical space. And then later, a media company would come in and put digital content on the screens. And I said, we can't do that for this experience. It'll be terrible. We have to have those digital people at the beginning with the physical people working hand in hand. And that was a major disruption for everybody, because they went, we just don't do that. Like, we're often in the same room at the same time with these people. So the mere process of involving digital content or mixed reality content people in earlier in the design process is a struggle. And it really begins with the final stakeholders. If you can get the final stakeholders to sign off on that, then you get those people involved in the process. And then you start going like, here's an interesting thing. Let me give you a couple of examples of what happens. The architectural firm and the construction firm were building, and the digital team said, hey, your elevators are too small. And they were like, what are you talking about? Like, we do this for a living. Like, who the fuck are you? We make this shit for a living. How can you tell us the elevator's too small? And I was like, well, because I stood in it. And they're like, you can't stand in it. It's a hole in the ground. We haven't built anything yet. And I was like, no, I know, but we took your BIM files. We built a digital twin of the thing. And I'm in VR walking around the space. And I'm just telling you, your piece of paper says that this elevator holds 17 people. And I'm telling you, it holds 6. And they're like, that's not possible. And what they found was, they went, oh shit, sure enough. We put that elevator in there based on weightings, and the weight ratings would support 17 people, but the space ratings don't. So damn it, that's correct. We have a bottleneck now, so we need to make a change to the design of this place. And then they were like, hang on, what are you doing in there? I'm like, I'm walking around in VR checking out your building. And they were like, well, how's this one hallway? We thought that maybe that might be too pinched. And it was like, yeah, it is too pinched. You should take that out like 3 feet. So next thing you know, we're flying through there, we're putting concept art on the walls, we're saying, hey, these are the materials for this surface, and here we're gonna have a projector that creates an environment over there. And so we took a holistic view to designing both the physical space architecture, the visitor flow, the visitor journey, the visitor experience, and all the digital content, then followed a final vision so that we could essentially, before construction was completed, provide a walkthrough of the finished experience rather than just saying, we put a screen there because we figured somebody would come up with something cool to justify putting a screen there. And so changing the processes of design to include all those voices and creating more designers who can think in a digital physical hybrid is a great opportunity. And let me give you one more example. This happens in the movie business a lot. Sometimes something that's really hard in the physical world is really easy in the digital world. And sometimes it's the reverse. So you've probably seen that there's a new trend in movies and television now to build rooms that are large LED screens and then build little movie sets inside them. And then they're kind of like Codex from Star Trek. You can go in there and you can film in any direction with this combination. So I've been involved in many of those processes before. And what we do is we say, hey, expensive for you to build, but not important for you to touch. And the production designer would be like, oh, well, this thing over here, I really want to build it, but it'll cost me $80,000 and I'm only using it in two shots. And I go, cool, we'll build that digitally. We'll put it on the screen and we'll have just this little piece here that you can at the end go lean on and touch. And then through the camera, it's all one coherent vision. So having the for a physical world person and a digital world person to say, I can do this for $50,000, you can do that for $200,000. It's the same thing to the user at the end of the day. So let's transfer and spend our money where it's most appropriate, where it really delivers the maximum impact. And that's kind of one of those other cool values. Sorry, there's more questions. Go for it.
Absolutely. Yeah. If we have time, I'll ask maybe one or two more. So kind of on that note of between going the mix of the digital and the physical space, it seems overwhelming. Even after someone learns the process of creating VR scenes, it seems difficult to understand all of the possibilities of both the digital and physical. So what kind of work can we as students do to learn or work in either physical and or digital design?
Well, okay, you're right. It's hard. I mean, I know that it's hard because I have a company here with like 150 people who I feel like we still haven't figured it all out, but we've been working on it for 7 years. I think we have moments where we get really excited about something that we figure out, but really a lot of it comes down to, you know, first of all, we really strongly espouse of the value of failure. A lot of times designers are afraid to fail. And if you're afraid to fail, then this is not the space, this is not the space for you. You should go follow somebody else doing what they've already done and just iterate, make minor improvements on a previous design. Because the thing that you have to embrace if you are going to move into this space is that, first of all, you are absolutely wrong. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you think. You cannot sit down and meditate on a mountaintop and say, aha, I have divined the amazing experience and now it just must be executed. You're wrong. You're an idiot. Screw you. Get out of here. I made that mistake for the first 3 years of this company. I was like, dude, I know shit about things. I can totally just like close my eyes and go, okay, it's probably like this, probably like that. Okay, let's build it. And then, you know, $1 million later, I'm like, boy, that's terrible. I was so sure that that was going to be great, but it's terrible. And there's all these lessons that you're going to learn along the way, and they're all going to come from failure. They're like, coming from the movie business, I always thought, oh, the visual fidelity of how the quality of everything looks is critical. We have to hold that bar. Wrong. It's totally wrong. It's totally, 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 totally wrong. Humans, and I can now say this from 7 years of testing, humans value interactivity over visual quality every single time. Every time, like, I'm like, oh, here, I made a really shitty looking experience that's fun to play with. And everyone's like, yeah. And then you say, look at this amazing, totally photoreal thing, but don't touch anything because you can't move it. And they're like, neat. And they watch it once and they walk away. So we've done tons of experiences in VR that have learned all these lessons. And for us, they've just been 7 years of rapid prototyping. So the point is, first of all, embrace failure. You're going to need to fail a lot to learn these things. The other thing is a little bit trickier. Because if you really want to make immersive and interactive experiences, right now the best tools that you have are unfortunately game engines. I say unfortunately because game engines are kind of really super complicated. And it's really hard. There's this triad at the company here where we have designers and we have artists, who make, you know, 3D models, visuals, all that kind of stuff, character animation, that kind of thing. And then we have engineers. And in engineering, you've got like cloud-hosted engineers, interaction engineers, game engineers, C++, C#, like totally different people, Python, scripting, DevOps, like it's immense. Same thing with art, you know, animals, modelers, textures, lighters, like there's a million things. Narrative designers, interaction designers, UI, UX, like it's really hard to be balanced across this triad and then sit down in front of a game engine and go, oh, okay, what? And it's a handful. So it's going to be tough. As a designer, you have a little bit more flexibility to focus on the teamwork aspect, which is to say, let's all work together. I want to know what the engineer's limitations and opportunities are. I want to know what the artist's limitations and opportunities are. And as a designer, I want to help guide these processes. And the more you can get your fingers dirty with the tools, the more capable you'll be as a designer. But I cannot emphasize enough how important it is for you to humble yourself before the design gods and say, I know nothing. Because every time somebody says, I know exactly what to do, I go through that experience and I'm like, I hate you and I want to choke you because I have now, it's actually a much more critical thing and immersive, because on mobile thing, I just go, sucks, and I swipe it away. But when I'm in a VR experience, I'm inside the body of another person experiencing that firsthand. And I've had people, that, not saying that you're going to design VR experiences, but I have actually had people get so angry in less than 5 seconds because something didn't work the way that they wanted, that they actually ripped the headset off and smashed it on the ground and like walked out and couldn't come back. Because you're inside of a bad design that somebody else is like, I don't understand. I really like that. It's like, what the fuck is the matter with you? That was horrible. I couldn't stand it. I was inside of it. I was trapped. Ugh. So, yeah, you got to really be fearless.
I think that's a great place to end. We really cannot thank you enough for your time, for making us all laugh and hearing about your incredible work and experiences. It's been such a pleasure. So thank you so much, Ben.
Well, I'm glad. I'm glad to hear people laugh. I didn't see anybody laughing. So I was
laughing and
thinking maybe I was talking to myself. Okay. Well, if for no other reason than that I got to appreciate the value of the emoji keyboard on my phone, thank you all very much for giving me the opportunity to speak to you today. If you ever want to follow up with any questions, I'm just ben@magnopus.com, and go out there and make the world a better place.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Cordia. I appreciate the invitation.
Of course.